Lisa Mbulivinaka and welcome to Tangata Pasifika. On tonight's show, language is no barrier for this motivational speaker.
So if you want to be a leader tomorrow, you got to join Toastmaster. If you want to be better in public speaking, you got to join Toastmaster.
A tourism venture in Aitutaki offering something special.
When I started last year building this place, and I knew it's going to work because there's nothing like it.
And we meet a Niuean who's clocked up over 100 marathons.
Because after doing 50, I thought that was it. And then I just thought, oh, well, I'll just carry on.
But first, suicide, a taboo subject that doesn't get talked about enough. The alarming rates within the Tongan community meant that it was on the agenda at this week's leaders' gathering at Auckland University of Technology. John Pulu was there.
Today's lesson's a matter of life and death.
One of the things which is alarming lately is our young people. There's a few of them coming in with attempted self-harm.
In the last 18 months, Tongans accounted for up to 30 suicide deaths, the highest of New Zealand's Pacific communities.
Some of the parents have a big expectation. A child don't want to disappoint their parents, and this is their way of coping, is harming themselves. So harming, in a way, just to get rid of the pain or get rid of the feeling of failure.
But when it comes to international comparisons of suicide, New Zealand rate quite high.
The most recent figures show around 500 people committed suicide in 2010. What's concerning is more than 2,000 people attempted suicide in the same year.
For those working in the front line, they're urging parents to keep a close eye on their children.
Parents have no clue, you know, that their daughter or their son, you know, will do such a thing, you know. But I guess the more you spend time with your kids, you know, at a young age until they're growing up, you know, the more you know them very well.
The challenge is taking the knowledge from the conference and making a difference in the communities.
We don't just come here and talk about it, but then we have to go back home into our community, into our family, into our society, and then put them in practice and help our youth leaders to face with it, you know, with the problem.
And you can find more information about suicide prevention on our website. In other news, former world champion discus thrower, Olympian and Commonwealth gold medalist Beatrice Fonwina has added another highlight to her amazing list of achievements, but not in athletics.
That's right. Beatrice has been awarded a Sir Peter Blake Leadership Award, one of seven candidates chosen for their outstanding contribution in their respective fields. At a function in Auckland on Friday night, the seven candidates were honoured. Beatrice's work as CEO of the Best Leadership Academy secured her award, which described her as inspiring a new generation of Pasifika people.
Really, the whole initiative behind Best Leadership Academy was developing Pasifika leaders, and there's so many people out there, whether they've been a part of the program as a mentor, as a student, and also a supporter and a sponsor. This is really a together, what I call a family recognition for our work.
The top award on the night, the Blake Medal, went to Youth Court Judge Mick Brown. Well done, Beatrice, and congratulations to the musical Island Boys too. Last Sunday, they took out the Silver Award at the Barbershop Harmony Society International Convention in Toronto. Congratulations.
Fantastic work. Well, it's mid-semester break for tertiary students in New Zealand, and while many are enjoying some time off for their studies, Samoan students' associations from around the country gathered together to celebrate their cultural roots at the annual Sōtanga.
This year's host, Victoria University in Wellington. John Pulu has more.
These tertiary students are moving to a different beat. No, it's not Polyfest or the Pasifika Festival. This is Sōtanga.
Sōtanga has given us this opportunity to be Samoan, to be able to celebrate your culture, leave our language.
This unique celebration dates back to the late 1970s in a bid to retain Fa'a Samoa. And this year, there are five universities participating with more than 200 students taking part. In the five-day conference, students are involved in sports, religion, academic debates, as well as learning about their culture. And while the occasion is aimed at reconnecting students with their roots, it's also attracted non-Samoan students to take part.
So I joined Sōtanga in 2010. When we were first years at university, and now we're the seniors of the group, so it's quite fun to come back and
still dance with them.
But this is more than a cultural experience. For Giselle Patel, the skills she's gained here at Sortanga can be carried over to the workforce.
When I do get my degree, on my CV I put in, I was the president of WASA, and say I was proud and include the things that went about of being president, preparations, fundraising, leadership skills, and I know a lot of workplaces need a lot of determined people.
Moving forward, it's up to these students to make these new skills part of their everyday lives.
Now, the overall winner of this year's Sortanga is Victoria University.
As far as public speaking goes, the Pacific is yet to have our own Tony Robbins-type motivational speaker, although there is one in the making.
Yes, Tangalotele Osone Okesene has uncovered a likely candidate with the potential to fill that spot and quite possibly be New Zealand's first Pasifika motivational speaker. He's a man
with a plan. Ami Pepe has a deliberate plan and he's ticking off the boxes as he completes each challenge en route to his ultimate goal.
To make it to the international level as a motivational public speaker.
Currently employed at the Martin Holtis Institute as an employment broker, gives Ami plenty of practice at motivating people to reach higher.
I build the confidence with all these clients, so I develop a program where we can identify the needs, what needs to be done with these clients, and then we teach them, we train them.
English is Ami's second language. When he arrived from Samoa at the age of 20, his vocabulary was limited. It was advice from a neighbour that helped him improve his English skills.
An English teacher that used to live right next door to us, she said to me, Ami, look, if you read 10, 15 minutes a day, if you can speak to 50 people a day, you'll pick up English just like that. And that's what I did.
A little over a year ago, Ami decided to enter the world of Toastmasters and signed up to the Manukau Club.
If you go on a website, it says where leaders are made. So if you want to be a leader tomorrow, you've got to join Toastmaster. If you want to be better in public speaking, you've got to join Toastmaster.
He was inspirational from his very first speech, and we knew right away we had someone special.
Within 6 months, Ami was already competing at the national finals for the Toastmaster's humorous speech.
If I went out there and got me a man to teach me English, how much English would I be able to learn from another man?
It's the passion to inspire and motivate that's really driven Ami. He's virtually eating, drinking and sleeping his public speeches.
If public speaking is what you want, you make sure you do it every day. I'll make sure I have the time for the family. Once they go to sleep, I go in the garage, I go in the sitting room and I speak to myself. I do it every night. When people ask me, how did he get there so fast? And that's the story I tell.
He would go to empty halls, stand on the stage and talk. Just present a speech to no one in the audience, but that was how I did it. That's how dedicated he was.
The Manukau Club meet once a fortnight, and it's here that Ami hones his skills.
Well, he listens very carefully because that's what he's joined Toastmasters for. When you present a speech at Toastmasters, you also have an evaluation. He would have received a lot of his learning by listening very carefully for that.
In May this year, Ami challenged for the International Speech Champion of New Zealand and the chance to represent Aotearoa at the World Champs. Coming third hasn't dampened his enthusiasm.
It's not getting that first ticket, it's getting the ticket to get up on a stage all the time. That's a winner. I'm ready to go for next year. I really want to represent New Zealand.
If he can go that far in 1 year, I would say his goal of a motivational speaker is very, very much going to be something he's going to attain with ease.
Please make a commitment to yourself that you can do it to achieve those goals and those dreams. And please, take your bag with you.
Good work, Ami. All right, after the break, Nga'a's cultural project becomes a reality.
Creating this, Punare culture tour, it's something very important, not just for me, but for our people, especially the young generations.
Welcome back to Tangata Pasifika. To Aitutaki in the Cook Islands now, where tourism continues to go from strength to strength on the back of some strong promotion in countries like New Zealand and Australia.
And it's this interest that's driven one enterprising local man into offering a cultural experience for visitors, which could help reinvigorate flagging interest in Aitutaki history and culture. John Utanga explains.
It's one of the most idyllic spots in the South Pacific, a mecca for visitors willing to spend that little bit extra for a slice of paradise. So seemingly Aitutaki has it all, or does it? Well, not according to a local guide who says it's sadly lacking in any kind of cultural experience. What's missing is the opportunity to immerse yourself into Aitutakian culture. It's an idea he's passionate about, and one that has the added bonus of helping to revive traditional knowledge and culture in a community that's fast losing it. A hill above Aitutaki's white sandy beaches are where these visitors are heading. To the Punare Cultural Village, brainchild of local man Ngaakitai Puriariki.
It's very important for me. It's a dream of mine. For almost the time I arrived back here, you know, 2002. But it's taking me a while to get here where I am now.
Nga spent many years in Melbourne before returning home to work as a tour guide, but he'd always wanted to start up his own cultural village, and a year ago, he got his chance.
When I started last year building this place, and I knew it's going to work, because there's nothing like it. The lagoon flooded with the activity, but the cultural aspect of it like this, none of them. Yeah, you got the dancing, island night, and things like that, but you need to interact more. With the culture as well, we put it into a good humour. You know, some culture is very serious, but for us, Aitutaki, we're easygoing. And adding the culture to it, it's a bonus.
Beautiful! Nga says the Punare was inspired by his own childhood on the island, a lifestyle he says is fast disappearing in this community today.
I used to go down to a beach with grandma and get some kai, you know, get some other ruko down the beach, come with the swampy area, pull all that, and then come up to the house. My granddad is there already, prepared the, you know, the omu, and then we start putting it together, cover it up, and then from there we go get the coconut, create a coconut, make tai, which is the coconut sauce, and I don't see that anymore.
After a short tour through the village, visitors are taken further inland, the highlight of which is a visit to the Arangirea Marae in the Taravao district. Here, visitors get an insight into pre-Christian religious practices.
It's mainly the preparations of the meal for the ceremony.
The site used to be covered by the nearby jungle, but it was cleared back in 2006. 2 years later, it was excavated by a team led by Tahiti-based archaeologist Mark Eddowes. Nga'a was proud to be part of that excavation team.
I cannot express how happy I was. I think the words is not happy. It's more or less of a excitement of seeing who I am. It's my identity. People are different in these days. And then when you think of the ancestor, how they do things, spiritual way, and loving the planet they had and respecting it, it's amazing. For me, you know, going through the research, it's one of the highlights of my life.
Because when we found some of the charcoal here, they burn it.
Working on the dig inspired Nga'a to find out more about Aitutaki culture. Part of the reason for setting up the Punare Cultural Village is to help raise funds to do more excavations on the site.
Yes, we do have some funding, but, you know, it's not enough to do the research, you know. You think of carbon dating, charcoals and things like testing. Those kind of things is quite expensive to come by, especially in the Cook Island.
Originally, our people come from the interior.
Nga'a's an old hand at the tour guide business, but he admits getting support for the cultural village and his marae visit has been a struggle. But there's been one positive. Local attitudes towards marae have changed, particularly from the church community.
You know, with the religious people as well, you know, I thank them. They realise now culture and religious go together. And the support now, today, it's brilliant. But if if I was 30, 40 years ago, I don't think so will be that strong.
Back at the cultural village, Nga'a's visitors get a chance to take part in a traditional game called Papatopi before settling down for a well-earned umu lunch.
That's breadfruit and arrowroot salad.
Nga'a employs 3 locals at the village and is hopeful of growing more opportunities, but his main motivation for setting up the village has to do with empowering young Aitutakians.
Creating this, Punare culture tour, it's something very important, not just for me, but for our people, especially the young generations. We don't know much about our culture, to be honest with you. You know, most of our elderly people, they're in New Zealand now, and none of them here don't know much about our culture.
And Nga is hopeful the village will encourage a new generation of dreamers with a can-do attitude like his.
The most important thing for me is I want to open up these channel for the young generation. I know when we open this channel, there's a lot of young children on this island will become an entrepreneur, painting, carving, craft, you name it.
For now, this cultural warrior is just happy to share part of the rich Aitutaki experience with the world.
Oh, I wish I was in Aitutaki right now. Well, time now for community notices brought to you this week with a track by Caval called Supernova. Step outside into the cold. Tell me, do you miss the warmth at all? No, the hardest things appear to see. Yeah, I know you're sick of being broke, broke, broke. And I know you want it all. So let it play. But please don't fear the fall. If you wanna be bigger than the world, bigger than the world, supernova. Bigger than the world, bigger than the world, supernova.
All right, most of us have never run a marathon, so after the break, we meet Mele, who has done over 100.
Oh, thank you, dear. It's hard when people ask you, is this your first one? I said, no, it's going to be my 102 today. Well, I guess they look at me and because I don't look like a runner. You know, they expect people to be skin and bones, I suppose.
Welcome back to Tangata Pasifika. Well, it's fantastic to see so many of our Pacific people getting into fitness and having healthier lifestyles.
Absolutely. And it's no surprise to see Hulanesian fitness, essentially the Cook Islands version of Zumba, hitting the marketplace. Tangaloa Tele Osone Okesene has this story.
Jane Archer's a woman on a mission.
Some energy, people!
She's promoting Hulanesian fitness as a way for Pacific women to get healthy and stay that way.
I haven't danced for 25 years. I feel sad that I didn't have anywhere to go to dance. So I'm saying to all the mamas out there, tūkeronga, get up, come and join us. This program is for you too, but not just them. The beautiful young children, the next generation coming through, I want them to learn who they are.
It's not a new concept, but Jane's passion for Hulanesian fitness is infecting the punters in the class.
I love getting a fun workout as well as dancing. I love dancing, so doing something I love and working out at the same time is a bonus.
Oh, I love it. I'm telling you, I try and encourage all my work colleagues to come and join, by a lot of excuses, but never mind. I'm not going to stay home. I'm going to come and enjoy myself, yeah.
Based over the ditch on Aussie's Gold Coast, Jane's personal rediscovery of hula has grown a following on both shores.
The women in Australia love it. There's such a demand on where are we going to be, when are the classes held. There's so many women, that, especially Australian women, they're the ones that are really inspiring other women to attend our classes.
I bought the authentic Cook Island songs that I grew up with. I wanted them to have a little taste of what it was like to actually be Polynesian and actually be able to dance these dance.
This class, run at the Otahuhu Recreation Centre, draws in women of all shapes, sizes and ages, all wanting to have their fun with the exercise while doing something familiar.
It's my culture, it's really important to me, this event tonight, and it makes me want to, oh yes. They're going to dance in Cook Island, I better be there.
We dance to that like nearly every day, all those beats. And to the songs, we like listen to it. My uncle just jams it and then we sing along and we have fun. Hey.
Configure Express in Auckland CBD is already interested in running the Hulanesian fitness program. Today's a training session for women keen to run classes.
When you come to our trainings, I'll show you. You need to go home and practice and practice and practice until you're okay with it. There's no right or wrong way.
What I love about it is that I'm also learning, not only myself, but other women are learning how to dance, how to express themselves as women.
The youngest of Jane's team, Amy Lee, was attracted to the classes because of its Polynesian cultural roots.
Just bringing me back to culture, really, just being around that whole family atmosphere and Polynesian people and that whole vibe of family, because we live in Australia, we don't we don't have any family there ourselves, so hula is like family to us now.
So if hula is your thing, Hulanesian fitness could be for you.
I don't think my hips would be loose enough to do that, but it looks like fun.
I think you'd do all right. Actually, I started a sport. I forgot to tell you about it. I've been doing some boxing.
Oh, cool.
Been hitting the bakeries.
And still keeping active. Running a marathon is not for the faint-hearted. It's 42 kilometres to the finish line, but to get there takes endless hours of training and going through many pairs of running shoes. Now, Niuean woman Mal Tuineau, who is in her early 50s, ran her first marathon 24 years ago. In May this year, she clocked up her 100th in Rotorua.
Inspiring stuff, but she didn't stop there. She recently travelled to the capital to compete in the Wellington Marathon. Sandra Kailahi was there to witness another one of Mal's milestones.
Let's get it started in here.
And the bass keeps running, running, and running, running,
and running, running, and running, running, and running, running, and running, running, and running, running, and running, running, and
this is a road well travelled by Mal Tuineau. She's using the Wellington event to complete her 102nd marathon. That equates to 4,284 kilometres.
To put it into perspective, it's like running from Cape Reinga all the way to the Bluff and back again. But because Mal is Niuean, it's also like running around Niue 67 times.
I know, I can't believe it myself. Because after doing 50, I thought that was it. And then I just thought, oh, well, I'll just carry on and see if I can maintain my health. And I got to 80 and I thought, oh, it's not long to go till 100.
Mal first started running to get fit, trying 5 and 10K runs, before friends suggested she join the Wellington Marathon Clinic and the Hutt Valley Running Club, where she discovered a real love for the exercise.
It comes back to really my dad and his parents, also my auntie Sweetie, who always said to us that, you know, your health and God is important in your life. I met Malcolm, my present partner, who is into running, and that's how I got into it.
Mal since moved to Auckland and is with the YMCA Marathon Club. These days she slow jogs or fast walks, but she always finishes.
How do you do that?
Just time on your feet and focus at the end.
I'm happy because that's a great improvement from the last one. Oh, thank you, dear. It's hard when people ask you, is this your first one? I said, no, it's going to be my 102 today. Well, I guess they look at me and don't, because I don't look like a runner, you know, they expect people to be skin and bones, I suppose.
Mal ran her first marathon in 1989 in Hastings in just over 4.5 hours. Her first overseas marathon was in the Gold Coast, but she's done the big ones, London, Paris, and even New York.
I like the New York and London because they've got so much entertainment and you can stop to have a feed, have a massage, can dance with the band. Yeah, incredible.
And then she just kept going. Mal reached the 50 marathon mark at the Rotorua event and chose it again when she reached the 100 mark in May.
Well, when I did the 50, I thought, well, I'll be the first Niuean to do 50, and now just over 100. It's quite amazing.
And she's got the medals to show for it. And if you're thinking of doing a marathon, this humble Niuean has some simple tips.
Good eating habits, enough sleep, being happy and enjoy life.
Mal, you are incredible. And she's been at it again. She just completed her 10th Gold Coast Marathon last weekend. Her total is now 103 marathons. Go, Mal.
Wow. Congratulations, Mal. Well, that's our show this week. Do join us again next week. Remember, you can catch all our stories and find out what's happening in the community online at tvnz.co.nz, keyword Tangata Pasifika. On Facebook, just like us. And we're on YouTube as well.
Have a great weekend, everyone. Till fasui fua.
Mau mea. To our new homebound.